Hey friends, welcome back to my channel. Hope you're all keeping safe and well, and welcome to another monthly recap video. This time around, I'm happy to say things are pretty much back to normal now that I've been getting out and about a lot more, having recovered from my health issues that I had over the summer. So in particular, I've been able to go to the theatre for the first time in 20 months for a couple of shows, which has been fantastic. And I've been out and about for some nice walks to see some lovely things as well. So there's all that kind of stuff to tell you about. Plus, I've been enjoying TV shows, movies and music as per usual as well. So there's a lot to cover in this month's video. And as always, there's a lot more detail in the blog post to go with it, because these videos are only ever a summary, so I'm not rambling away for hours. And in particular, there's actually several blog posts you can read this month if you want to, not just the favourites summary, but also a more detailed blog post about certain things as well, if you have the inclination and time to do so. And they'll be mentioned in the description below as appropriate, of course. For example, there's actually a post about the new iPhone 13 that I'm filming this on that I bought recently, which replaces my iPhone 6. Gives my first impressions, basically, and the accessibility features I like to use. But basically, it's a much better device. Obviously, upgrading from the 6 to the 13 is going to be a huge improvement. And the screen's much better and it's much faster to use. The battery life's much better. The video and photo quality is a lot better as well. So everything about it is just brilliant compared to the iPhone 6, which was a good model in itself and lasted me a good long time. But it's been time to upgrade and it's been well worth it. Nothing in this video or in my blog post is sponsored or gifted, apart from the States of Mind theatre show that I went to, which I got complimentary tickets to go and review. But even for that, as well as everything else, all opinions are my own regardless. I'll never get paid to express a certain opinion. So all opinions are my own throughout. And yeah, that's basically all I have to say by way of an introduction. As I say, there's plenty to cover. So I think it's best if we just crack on with it. And I hope you enjoy it. So starting off with the theatre shows I saw, and the first was States of Mind, which was a production by the visually impaired performance group Extant at the RADA Studios as part of the Bloomsbury Festival. This is a premiere production of a piece written by visually impaired writer and director Christopher Hunter and starring visually impaired performers Gillian Dean and Robin Paley-York. It's a contemporary dramatisation of Shakespeare's poem Venus and Adonis, his first ever published work. And it's a powerful exploration of the conflicting feelings brought on by love and lust. So it's quite a deep play, it's quite a thoughtful play, but there's humour in there as well, and there's a lot of great interplay between the two characters and indeed the two performers. There was integrated audio description as well, which was really useful, basically delivered by an unseen character watching the two main characters in the medical examination room. So that was quite nicely integrated. And yeah, I found it very engaging, very interesting. I still have a bit of trouble understanding Shakespeare's language sometimes, trying to decode it. But this time it wasn't too bad, actually. It wasn't too difficult to understand. So I was able to follow the story most of the time. And if I had to catch up, then it wasn't too difficult to do so. But yeah, it was very interesting and engaging. I did feature on this channel a little while ago an interview with Gillian Dean, one of the actors, and it was very generous of her to give up so much of her time to record such detailed answers to the questions that I sent her. And Christopher Hunter also answered some questions I published on my blog as well. So do go and check those bits and pieces out, and also my review of the play that I published in my blog as well. And then in complete contrast to that, the other production I saw was an audio-described performance of the Rocky Horror Show, which has been on my bucket list for ages because I've been a fan of the film and the music for many years. So when an accessible performance finally came up, I had to jump at the opportunity to go and see it, or jump to the left, as the song goes, of course. It was put on by Sadler's Wells, the Peacock Theatre, with Strictly Come Dancing winner Oria Duba as Brad and various other great performers. And it was just so funny, and the songs are so great, and the choreography is excellent. And I joined in with the audience callbacks, of course, at the traditional, and danced along with the time warp in the encore. And it was just a great atmosphere in there. It was fantastic to be back in a full auditorium for a big musical like that. And yeah, I loved it. It was long overdue, but I'm glad I finally lost my Rocky Horror virginity, as it were. You know, they didn't do any virgin sacrifices on stage like some productions might do around the world. And there wasn't a touch tour either for the audio described performance, which was a shame but perfectly understandable. But yeah, I had a good view from the seat I had, and the audio description was excellent, so I didn't miss out anything from the show at all. And I already know it very well anyway. It was just great to be able to go to a Rocky Horror performance in person for the first time, and it won't be the last by any means. And to celebrate that, I also wrote a special Halloween trilogy in my blog all about Rocky Horror. So the first post was about the movie and the Blu-ray and other filmed productions, and a mention of Shock Treatment as well, which is kind of the follow-up film that came out, and that also became a stage musical for a little while as well. But Rocky Horror is by far the best and well-known of Richard O'Brien's productions. And then the second post was about the soundtrack albums and some of the cover songs as well. And then the third post was about my experience at the live show and some of the merchandise I bought. So I got t-shirts and a couple of programs. And then also my friend Claire recommended a podcast that came out that weekend as well, purely by coincidence. It's called Talk Description to Me, and they audio describe things every week, basically, for their visually impaired audience. And on this particular Halloween weekend, they decided to do the Rocky Horror Show. So the host, JJ, who has been in a shadow cast and stage adaptation of the show himself, goes into great detail about the film and the Rocky Horror phenomenon in general. So it's a great introduction to Rocky Horror if you're really not familiar with it. So I'll link to that in the description below as well, because it's really interesting. And then in terms of going out and about for walks, the longest walk I had this month that's worth mentioning was a lovely stroll I had around Regent's Park, which is always a nice area to look around anyway. But once again, they had their Frieze Sculpture Trail this month, which is basically a set of modern artworks that they spread around the park by different artists for people to go and look at. So here they had a stack of colourful boulders, a large white pineapple, and a huge structure that looked like a bullet to me, among lots of other weird and wonderful things. You know, some of them don't make much sense, and the signs next to them don't really make it any clearer either sometimes. But they are fun to look at. It's nice to go and see what you find there, because you never quite know what's around the next corner. And I took some photos around the park in general, of course, as well. So yeah, it was really nice to have a long stroll around there in the nice weather. So then moving on to things that I've been watching, and this month I decided to try a couple of foreign dramas on Netflix that people have been raving about on social media, with English dubbed audio, of course, because I can't understand foreign languages and I can't read subtitles either, so it's the only way I can watch them. And both of these dramas revolve around the same basic premise, where a group of people are forced to play a series of games in this strange new environment, and the stakes are very high, because if you lose, you die, basically. So there's a lot of drama and tension and suspense and distress and some action, violence and gore as well, because it's obviously very difficult to survive these games. And obviously the most prominent of those dramas is Squid Game, which has been very recently released in September. It's been the talk of the internet ever since. And this is a survival drama from South Korea, where the contestants are people who are heavily in debt, and they're persuaded to take part in children's games for a huge jackpot that will set them up for life. And the players have all volunteered, so you know they know what they're getting into, and they could choose to go back to the outside world, but there's just nothing for them, and things look so bleak for them out there that this is the best hope they have of moving on with their lives. So yeah, that's quite weird, but also quite interesting as well, quite fun. It does keep you engaged throughout, that's for sure. And then the other gaming drama I watched was a Japanese thriller series called Alice in Borderland that came out in December last year. And here the victims are transported to an abandoned version of Tokyo, just suddenly, without realising what's going to happen, completely against their will this time, and they have to take part in deadly competitions in order to extend their visas to stay in this new world, otherwise they just die, and if you lose in the games, you die as well. And it's another good show, you know, it's got interesting games and characters and storylines and things, but it does kind of change halfway through, and they arrive at this place called the beach, and the style of the show changes a bit from that point. It doesn't work quite as well, it's still okay, it's still well worth a watch. And then I also watched various films this month, not just the Rocky Horror Picture Show that I watched for the umpteenth time while I was preparing for the live show, but also various other things as well. So I watched Escape Room Tournament of Champions, which is the sequel to the original Escape Room film, and as the name suggests, these films are about people who get trapped in escape rooms and they have to get out of them, but these are very elaborately designed escape rooms and very deadly ones as well, so most of the contestants don't make it through alive, and they're good fun, you know, I wouldn't buy them to keep by any means, but they're entertaining. And then on another gaming theme, I saw a film called Game Night on TV, which is about players of a specially arranged murder mystery night who get together, and they get more than they're bargained for when one of the group is kidnapped for real and they have to go on this dangerous journey to try and rescue him. And it's very silly and a bit crude and deliberately far-fetched, but it's good fun, and there are a few plot twists thrown in as well, and I wouldn't watch it again necessarily, I certainly wouldn't buy it, but it was a nice way to kill an evening, so to speak. And then I did also watch a few horror films over the Halloween weekend as well, keeping on the deadly theme. There's a bit of a trend this month, I know, but these were available on BBC iPlayer, so I thought I'd watch them. And The Exorcist was on again for a start, so I figured I'd watch that again, because it's been many years since I last saw that, so I didn't really remember it very clearly, but I know I have seen it before. And it is fairly entertaining, you know, you've got the little girl becoming possessed and increasingly violent, and the others attempting to stop her, and there's great performances and music in it, but there are quite a lot of parts of the film which are quite kind of slow and boring, with nothing really happening. And bearing in mind I wasn't alive when the film first came out, it doesn't impact me as much as it did people back then, because back then there wasn't anything like it before. But now there's been so many horror films, and I've seen quite a few over the years, that it just doesn't impact me in the same way. But it's entertaining, it's still worth watching once, but I wouldn't buy it on DVD, and I'm not interested in the sequels or anything like that. It was just nice to see the original film again, because I hadn't done so for a long time. It's one of those films that, you know, you have to see once if you're into that genre, at the very least. And then I also saw the first two films in the Conjuring franchise, which are by director James Wan, who also did the Saw franchise. I think I prefer those films to the Conjuring ones, but they're still good nonetheless. They're still enjoyable as the families deal with people who have become demonically possessed, and the events, the result, become more and more erratic as a result. And the visuals and the music are very atmospheric and effective. And the second film set in London as well, which is a nice touch. So they were reasonably entertaining. They were good fun. And I'm not going to bother with all the prequels and spin-offs and stuff like that, but I'm going to see the third film, I think, that came out this year. That should be interesting to see as well. So yeah, I enjoyed watching all those different horror films. It was nice to have a variety of those this month. And then on a completely different and much lighter note, as a Toy Story fan, it was interesting to see that Pixar have released a teaser trailer for Lightyear, the spin-off prequel coming out next year. That looks good fun as well, so I'm hoping to watch that after that comes out. So then moving on to TV drama as opposed to online stuff that I've mentioned already. Season 7 of The Flash has now come to an end, and while it's had a few good moments here and there, I've now reached a point where I'm ready to duck out and move on to other things instead, because you know, even though I know they were screwed up by the pandemic for Season 6 and 7, it's been past its peak for a while really, and it's just been enough to keep me engaged, but I've just kind of really lost my way with it this season, I think. I think Cisco leaving really clinched it for me, you know, with him and House and Wells gone, it's just not the same anymore, because the new characters just aren't as interesting or as fun anymore, I don't think, and a lot of the original chemistry and humour from the show is now gone, and even Barry Allen, the lead character in the series, isn't as likable anymore, I don't think, because he's not naive and learning about his powers anymore, he's much more confident and taking charge and gets a bit full of himself, I think, sometimes, so it just doesn't feel as comfortable to watch anymore. Plus there's an increasing reliance on crossovers with other shows in the Arrowverse, as they call it, and I've never been into the other shows. I've tried them, things like, you know, Supergirl and Arrow and stuff like that, but I've just not been as interested in them, not got as engaged in them, so I don't know who a lot of the people are and everything. And the first 5 episodes of Season 8 of The Flash are going to be a big crossover event, so yeah, it's just the right time to step away, I think. It's been a good series, I've enjoyed 7 seasons of it, but it's time to move on. So moving on to TV comedy, and despite all the dramas and films I mentioned earlier, the most entertaining games of the month have of course come out of Taskmaster as usual. The current series is brilliant, you know, with a great mix of contestants and tasks and everything. I'm loving Victoria, Cora Mitchell and Alan Davis in particular because I know them best, but everyone's brilliant together. And they also recorded the next Champion of Champions special in September too, so that's coming up soon, featuring the winners of series 6 to 10, so we've got that to look forward to as well. And then Greg Davis is also the new host for the revival of Nevermind the Buzzcocks on Sky. I always liked the series best when Mark Lamar hosted it on the BBC originally, because the replacements after him were never as good, but the 7-year hiatus and the change of broadcaster seem to have helped, and I'm really enjoying it. Greg's great as the host, and it's great that Noel Fielding has returned as a team captain, and Daisy May Cooper is good as the opposite team captain. Her laugh gets a bit irritating sometimes, but it is quite catchy in the right moments as well. And the guests are good as well. They get involved, and you've got all the same style of banter and questions and the same sort of rounds like intros, identity parade, and next lines, and other new rounds as well. Yeah, it's just really good fun. I'm enjoying it. And then I am, of course, still enjoying the latest series of The Last Leg and Have Got News For You, as per usual. And it's great that they've both got studio audiences back again now. Have Got News For You already had its audience back earlier in the year, but this series of The Last Leg is the first time they've had an audience back. So it's great to have that atmosphere back on the show on a Friday night. And then in terms of music, I've bought a few new releases by some of my favourite artists this month. So I got the new Super Deluxe 50th Anniversary box set of Let It Be by the Beatles. This is their final album. And as with previous box sets, you've got a brilliant package with a big hardback book with loads of interesting information and a remastered mix of the album on CD and Blu-ray, and then various extra things as well, like the original Glyn Johns mix of the album when it was called Get Back, an EP with a few more alternate mixes, and 2 discs of outtakes and rehearsals and jams. So that's really interesting to listen to all of that. And of course, we've got the upcoming Get Back documentary by Peter Jackson, the Oscar-winning filmmaker who did Lord of the Rings, which has been created using unseen footage of the band working on the Let It Be album in 1969. A film was made of the band back then called Let It Be, and that's going to also have a remastered release soon. But this is a much more comprehensive and much longer series, really. It's 3 2-hour episodes, which are going to be on Disney Plus towards the end of November. So I'm really looking forward to watching that. It'd be really interesting to see that. And then the Rolling Stones have released a 40th anniversary super deluxe edition of their album Tattoo You, which gave us the classic song Start Me Up. And there's an early version of that song included as one of the bonus tracks, which is really interesting. And another bonus track is called Living in the Heart of Love, which is quite good. Plus, there's a whole live concert from Wembley in 1982 they've thrown in. I didn't bother buying the physical box set for this one because there was a 12-inch vinyl picture disc in there, which shoots the price up significantly, and I have no use for it whatsoever. And all the other tracks are available to download anyway, so I just bought it as a download, which was nice.
nice and easy, which is fine. And yeah, it's been really fun to listen to that. And then Roger Taylor has released a brand new album called Outsider, which is his first new solo album in 8 years. It was inspired by the COVID lockdowns and featured a few tracks that have been previously released, including Journey's End from 2017, Gangsters Are Running the World from 2019, there were two mixes of that, and Isolation from 2020, and this year's single from the summer, We're All Just Trying to Get By, featuring Katie Tunstall. And there's also a cover of the Clapping song, originally by Shirley Ellis, and you may not recognise the name of the song, but you certainly know if you heard it, I'm sure. And I'm not as big a fan of Roger's solo work as Freddie's or Brian's, really, but it's still good, it's still a nice album. You know, there's some very thoughtful tracks on there, one or two catchy tracks as well, and it's still very nicely put together, so I'm still glad I got it. And then finally, moving away from Queen, but to someone who still had a massive musical impact, it's worth giving a respectful nod to Alan Hawkshaw, who passed away aged 84 in October. He was a prolific composer who worked with The Shadows and various other artists and recorded a lot of library music that people could license for use in TV shows, adverts, radio shows, films, etc., as they wished to. And you may not recognise the name Alan Hawkshaw, but if you live in the UK, you absolutely know some of the music he composed, because several of his tunes were used as TV theme tunes, some of the most famous ones we've ever had. So Best Endeavours is the theme used for Channel 4 News. They're still using it to this day. Chicken Man was the original theme tune used for Grange Hill from 1978 to 1989. It got changed to a different Peter Moss composition from 1990 to 2007, but then they brought Chicken Man back for the final series in 2008. And it was also used, funnily enough, for Give Us a Clue in 79 to 81, which confused people having the same tune used for two shows. He also arranged a classical piece called Promenade from Pictures at an Exhibition for the Rick Mayall sitcom The New Statesman. And he composed Studio 69, which was used for The Dave Allen Show and Dave Allen at Large, which older viewers may recognise. And then most famously of all, he composed the theme tune and the clock music for the game show Countdown on Channel 4. In fact, it was originally for a show called Canada Countdown on Yorkshire TV, which had a never broadcast pilot and a very short series that you can find on Daily Motion. But the format was then refined and became Countdown that we all know, and that's been running ever since Channel 4 started. And Alan generously donated a big portion of the royalties from that theme to Leeds College of Music. So every single time that theme tune is played, which is a hell of a lot now, when you consider how long it's been on TV for, they get a bit of money. So that's really, really generous of him. And he's left a great legacy with that tune, as well as many others. So yeah, farewell Alan Hawkshaw. You've made a great contribution to music and TV.
And that's it. I told you there was a lot to cover, didn't I? So I hope you found that interesting and enjoyable. And well done if you made it this far. And I'm looking forward to telling you about what I get up to in November and December and beyond. It's great to be able to get out and about a lot more like I used to again. And I've started booking up things in the calendar, not just for this year, but also next year as well. So I've got plenty to look forward to. Because you have to book well in advance to get decent prices and decent seats for some things. For example, I've started booking up to see some of my favourite stand-up comedians. So I'm already booked up to see Chris McCausland, Maisie Adams, Sarah Millican and Dara O'Brien as I film this. And I'm going to see a concert at the Royal Albert Hall next year of Queen hits being performed by the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, which should be excellent. And there'll be other things I book as well as time goes on. So yeah, I'm really looking forward to things that are on the horizon already. But yeah, that's it for this video at least. So thank you very much for watching that. I hope you enjoyed it. Do take care of yourselves and others in the weeks ahead as we go into the winter. My mother's had her COVID booster and her flu jab and her shingles jab, so she's well protected against various things this year, which is a relief. And yeah, don't forget to like, comment and subscribe as per usual. And I will see you for another video very soon. Bye for now.